What the Buddha Taught. Walpola Sri Rahula. Preface. All over the world today, there is growing interest in Buddhism. I have tried in this little book to address myself first of all to the educated and intelligent general reader, uninstructed in the subject, who would like to know what the Buddha actually taught. For his benefit, I have aimed at giving briefly, and as directly and simply as possible, a faithful and accurate account of the actual words used by the Buddha as they are to be found in the original Pali texts of the Tipitaka, universally accepted by scholars as the earliest extant records of the teachings of the Buddha. The material used and the passages quoted here are taken directly from these originals. In a few places, I have referred to some later works too. I have borne in mind, too, the reader who has already some knowledge of what the Buddha taught and would like to go further with his studies. I have therefore provided not only the Pali equivalents of most of the key words, but also references to the original texts in footnotes and a select bibliography. The difficulties of my task have been manifold. Throughout, I have tried to steer a course between the unfamiliar and the popular, to give the English reader of the present day something which could understand and appreciate, without sacrificing anything of the matter and form of the discourses of the Buddha. Writing the book, I have had the ancient texts running in my mind, so I have deliberately kept the synonyms and repetitions which were a part of the Buddha's speech as it has come down to us through oral tradition, in order that the reader should have some notion of the form used by the teacher. I have kept as close as I could to the originals and have tried to make my translations easy and readable. But there is a point beyond which it is difficult to take an idea without losing, in the interests of simplicity, the particular meaning the Buddha was interested in developing. As the title, What the Buddha Taught, was selected for this book, I felt that it would be wrong not to set down the words of the Buddha, even the figures he used, in preference to a rendering which might provide the easy gratification of comprehensibility at the risk of distortion of meaning. I have discussed in this book almost everything which is commonly accepted as the essential and fundamental teaching of the Buddha. These are the doctrines of the Four Noble Truths, the Noble Eightfold Path, the Five Aggregates, Karma, Rebirth, Conditioned Genesis, Paticca Samuppada, the Doctrine of No Soul, Satipatthana, the Setting Up of Mindfulness. Naturally, there will be in the discussion expressions which must be unfamiliar to the Western reader. I would ask him, if he is interested, to take up on his first reading the opening chapter, and then go on to chapters 5, 7, and 8, returning to chapters 2, 3, 4, and 6, when the general sense is clearer and more vivid. It would not be possible to write a book on the teaching of the Buddha without dealing with the subjects which Theravada and Mahayana Buddhism have accepted as fundamental in his system of thought. The term Theravada, Hinayana, or small vehicle, is no longer used in informed circles. Could be translated as the school of the elders, Theras, and Mahayana as great vehicle. They are used of the two main forms of Buddhism known in the world today. Theravada, which is regarded as the original orthodox Buddhism, is followed in Sri Lanka, Burma, Thailand, Cambodia, and Laos. Mahayana, which developed relatively later, is followed in other Buddhist countries like China, Japan, Tibet, Mongolia, and so on. There are certain differences, mainly with regard to some beliefs, practices, and observances between these two schools, but on the most important teachings of the Buddha, such as those discussed here, Theravada and Mahayana are unanimously agreed. Walpola Rahula, Paris, July 1958. Tumani, Sabadanang Damadanang Jinati. The gift of truth excels all other gifts. The Buddha. The Buddha, whose personal name was Siddhartha, Siddhartha in Sanskrit, and family name Gotama, in Sanskrit Gautama, lived in North India in the 6th century BC. His father, Suddhodana, was the ruler of the kingdom of the Sakyas in modern Nepal. His mother was Queen Maya. According to the custom of the time, he was married quite young, at the age of 16, to a beautiful and devoted young princess called Yasodhara. The young prince lived in his palace with every luxury at his command. But all of a sudden, confronted with the reality of life and the suffering of mankind, he decided to find the solution, the way out of this universal suffering. At the age of 29, soon after the birth of his only child, Rahula, he left his kingdom and became an ascetic in search of this solution. For 6 years, the ascetic Gotama wandered about the valley of the Ganges, meeting famous religious teachers, studying and following their systems and methods, and submitting himself to rigorous ascetic practices. They did not satisfy him. So he abandoned all traditional religions and their methods and went his own way. It was thus that one evening, seated under a tree, since then known as the Bodhi or Bow Tree, the Tree of Wisdom, on the bank of the river Naranjara, at Budh Gaya, near Gaya in modern Bihar, at the age of 35, Gotama attained enlightenment, after which he was known as the Buddha, the Enlightened One. After his enlightenment, Gotama the Buddha delivered his first sermon to a group of 5 ascetics, his old colleagues, in the deer park at Isipatana, modern Sarnath, near Benares. From that day, for 45 years, he taught all classes of men and women, kings and peasants, Brahmins and outcasts, bankers and beggars, holy men and robbers, without making the slightest distinction between them. He recognized no differences of caste or social groupings, and the way he preached was open to all men and women who were ready to understand and to follow it. At the age of 80, the Buddha passed away at Kusinara in modern Uttar Pradesh in India. Today, Buddhism is found in Sri Lanka, Burma, Thailand, Cambodia, Laos, Vietnam, Tibet, China, Japan, Mongolia, Korea, Taiwan, in some parts of India, Pakistan, Bangladesh, and Nepal, and also in Russia. The Buddhist population of the world is over 500 million. Chapter 1: The Buddhist Attitude of Mind. Among the founders of religions, the Buddha, if we are permitted to call him the founder of a religion in the popular sense of the term, was the only teacher who did not claim to be other than a human being, pure and simple. Other teachers were either God, or his incarnations in different forms, or inspired by him. The Buddha was not only a human being, he claimed no inspiration from any god or external power either. He attributed all his realization, attainments, and achievements to human endeavor and human intelligence. A man, and only a man, can become a Buddha. Every man has within himself the potentiality of becoming a Buddha, if he so wills it and endeavors. We can call the Buddha a man par excellence. He was so perfect in his humanness that he came to be regarded later in popular religion almost as superhuman. Man's position, according to Buddhism, is supreme. Man is his own master and there is no higher being or power that sits in judgment over his destiny. One is one's own refuge. Who else could be the refuge? Said the Buddha. He admonished his disciples to be a refuge to themselves, and never to seek refuge in or help from anybody else. He taught, encouraged, and stimulated each person to develop himself and to work out his own emancipation, for man has the power to liberate himself from all bondage through his own personal effort and intelligence. The Buddha says, "You should do your work, for the Tathagatas only teach the way." Footnote. This is the term usually used by the Buddha referring to himself and to the Buddhas in general. It means one who has come to truth, i.e., one who has discovered truth. End of footnote. If the Buddha is to be called a saviour at all, it is only in the sense that he discovered and showed the path to liberation, nirvana. But we must tread the path ourselves. It is on this principle of individual responsibility that the Buddha allows freedom to his disciples. In the Mahaparinibbana Sutta, the Buddha says that he never thought of controlling the Sangha, the order of monks, nor did he want the Sangha to depend on him. Footnote. Sangha literally means community, and in the modern Buddhist world often refers to all Buddhist followers, monastic and lay. But in traditional Buddhism, this term denotes the community of Buddhist monks. Buddha, Dhamma, teaching, and Sangha are known as Tisarana, three refuges, or Tiratana, triple gem. End of footnote. He said that there was no esoteric doctrine in his teaching, nothing hidden in the closed fist of the teacher. Or to put it in other words, there was never anything up his sleeve. The freedom of thought allowed by the Buddha is unheard of elsewhere in the history of religions. This freedom is necessary because, according to the Buddha, man's emancipation depends on his own realization of truth and not on the benevolent grace of a god or any external power as a reward for his obedient good behavior. The Buddha once visited a small town called Kesaputta in the kingdom of Kosala. The inhabitants of this town were known by the common name Kalama. When they heard that the Buddha was in their town, the Kalamas paid him a visit and told him, "Sir, there are some recluses and brahmanas who visit Kesaputta. They explain and illumine only their own doctrines, and despise, condemn, and spurn others' doctrines. Then come other recluses and brahmanas, and they too, in their turn, explain and illumine only their own doctrines, and despise, condemn, and spurn others' doctrines. But for us, sir, we have always doubt and perplexity as to who among these venerable recluses and brahmanas spoke the truth, and who spoke falsehood." Then the Buddha gave them this advice, unique in the history of religions. "Yes, Kalamas, it is proper that you have doubt, that you have perplexity, for a doubt has arisen in a matter which is doubtful. Now look you, Kalamas, do not be led by reports, or tradition, or hearsay. Be not led by the authority of religious texts, nor by mere logic or inference, nor by considering appearances, nor by the delight in speculative opinions, nor by seeming possibilities, nor by the idea, this is our teacher. But, O Kalamas, when you know for yourselves that certain things are unwholesome, akusala, and wrong and bad, then give them up. And when you know for yourselves that certain things are wholesome, kusala, and good, then accept them and follow them." The Buddha went even further. He told the bhikkhus that a disciple should examine even the Tathagata, the Buddha himself, so that he, the disciple, might be fully convinced of the true value of the teacher whom he followed. According to the Buddha's teaching, doubt is one of the five hindrances to the clear understanding of truth and to spiritual progress, or for that matter, to any progress. Footnote. The five hindrances are 1. Sensuous lust, 2. Ill will, 3. Physical and mental torpor and languor, 4. Restlessness and worry, 5. Doubt. End of footnote. Doubt, however, is not a sin because there are no articles of faith in Buddhism. In fact, there is no sin in Buddhism, as sin is understood in some religions. The root of all evil is ignorance, avidya, and false views, michaditti. It is an undeniable fact that as long as there is doubt, perplexity, wavering, no progress is possible. It is also equally undeniable that there must be doubt as long as one does not understand or see clearly. But in order to progress further, it is absolutely necessary to get rid of doubt. To get rid of doubt, one has to see clearly. There is no point in saying that one should not doubt or one should believe. Just to say, "I believe," does not mean that you understand and see. When a student works on a mathematical problem, he comes to a stage beyond which he does not know how to proceed and where he is in doubt and perplexity. As long as he has this doubt, he cannot proceed. If he wants to proceed, he must resolve this doubt. And there are ways of resolving that doubt. Just to say, "I believe," or "I do not doubt," will certainly not solve the problem. To force oneself to believe and to accept a thing without understanding is political and not spiritual or intellectual. The Buddha was always eager to dispel doubt. Even just a few minutes before his death, he requested his disciples several times to ask him if they had any doubts about his teaching and not to feel sorry later that they could not clear those doubts. But the disciples were silent. What he then said was touching. "If it is through respect for the teacher that you do not ask anything, let even one of you inform his friend," i.e., let one tell his friend so that the latter may ask the question on the other's behalf. Not only the freedom of thought, but also the tolerance allowed by the Buddha is astonishing to the student of the history of religions. Once in Nalanda, the Buddha was approached by a prominent and wealthy householder named Upali, a well-known lay disciple of Nigansha Nataputta, Jaina Mahavira. Footnote. Mahavira, founder of Jainism, was a contemporary of the Buddha and was probably a few years older than the Buddha. End of footnote. Upali was expressly sent by Mahavira himself to meet the Buddha and defeat him in argument on certain key points in the theory of karma, because the Buddha's views on the subject were different from those of Mahavira. Quite contrary to expectations, Upali, at the end of the discussion, was convinced that the views of the Buddha were right and those of his master were wrong. So he begged the Buddha to accept him as one of his lay disciples. But the Buddha asked him to reconsider it, and not to be in a hurry, for considering carefully is good for well-known men like you. When Upali expressed his desire again, the Buddha requested him to continue to respect and support his old religious teachers as he used to. In the 3rd century BC, the great Buddhist emperor Ashoka of India, following this noble example of tolerance and understanding, honored and supported all other religions in his vast empire. In one of his edicts, carved on rock, the original of which one may read even today, the emperor declared, "One should not honor only one's own religion and condemn the religions of others, but one should honor others' religions for this or that reason. So doing, one helps one's own religion to grow and renders service to the religions of others too. In acting otherwise, one digs the grave of one's own religion and also does harm to other religions. Whosoever honours his own religion and condemns other religions does so indeed through devotion to his own religion, thinking, "I will glorify my own religion." But on the contrary, in so doing he injures his own religion more gravely. So concord is good. Let all listen and be willing to listen to the doctrines professed by others. We should add here that this spirit of sympathetic understanding should be applied today not only in the matter of religious doctrine, but elsewhere as well. This spirit of tolerance and understanding has been, from the beginning, one of the most cherished ideals of Buddhist culture and civilization. That is why there is not a single example of persecution or the shedding of a drop of blood in converting people to Buddhism, or in its propagation during its long history of 2,500 years. It spread peacefully all over the continent of Asia, having more than 500 million adherents today. Violence in any form, under any pretext whatsoever, is absolutely against the teaching of the Buddha. The question has often been asked, is Buddhism a religion or a philosophy? It does not matter what you call it. Buddhism remains what it is, whatever label you may put on it. The label is immaterial. Even the label Buddhism, which we give to the teaching of the Buddha, is of little importance. The name one gives it is inessential. What's in a name? That which we call a rose, by any other name, would smell as sweet. In the same way, truth needs no label. It is neither Buddhist, Christian, Hindu, nor Muslim. It is not the monopoly of anybody. Sectarian labels are a hindrance to the independent understanding of truth, and they produce harmful prejudices in men's minds. This is true not only in intellectual and spiritual matters, but in human relations. When, for instance, we meet a man, we do not look on him as a human being, but we put a label on him, such as English, French, German, American, or Jew, and regard him with all the prejudices associated with that label in our mind. Yet he may be completely free from those attributes which we have put on him. People are so fond of discriminative labels that they even go to the length of putting them on human qualities and emotions common to all. So they talk of different brands of charity, as, for example, of Buddhist charity or Christian charity, and look down upon other brands of charity. But charity cannot be sectarian. It is neither Christian, Buddhist, Hindu, nor Muslim. The love of a mother for her child is neither Buddhist nor Christian. It is mother love. Human qualities and emotions like love, charity, compassion, tolerance, patience, friendship, desire, hatred, ill will, ignorance, conceit, and so on, need no sectarian labels. They belong to no particular religions. To the seeker after truth, it is immaterial from where an idea comes. The source and development of an idea is a matter for the academic. In fact, in order to understand truth, it is not necessary even to know whether the teaching comes from the Buddha or from anyone else. What is essential is seeing the thing, understanding it. There is an important story in the Majjhima Nikaya, Sutta number 140, which illustrates this. The Buddha once spent a night in a potter's shed. In the same shed, there was a young recluse who had arrived there earlier. Footnote: in India, potter's sheds are spacious and quiet. References are made in the Pali texts to ascetics and recluses, as well as to the Buddha himself, spending a night in a potter's shed during their wanderings. End of footnote. They did not know each other. The Buddha observed the recluse and thought to himself, "Pleasant are the ways of this young man. It would be good if I should ask about him." So the Buddha asked him, "O Bhikkhu, in whose name have you left home? Or who is your master? Or whose doctrine do you like?" "O friend," answered the young man, "there is the recluse Gotama, a Sakyan scion, who left the Sakya family to become a recluse. There is high repute abroad of him that he is an arahant, a fully enlightened one. In the name of that blessed one, I have become a recluse. He is my master, and I like his doctrine." "Where does that blessed one, the arahant, the fully enlightened one, live at the present time?" "In the countries to the north, friend, there is a city called Sarvati. It is there that the blessed one, the arahant, the fully enlightened one, is now living." "Have you ever seen him, that blessed one? Would you recognize him if you saw him?" "I have never seen that blessed one, nor should I recognize him if I saw him." The Buddha realized that it was in his name that this unknown young man had left home and become a recluse. But without divulging his own identity, he said, "O Bhikkhu, I will teach you the doctrine. Listen and pay attention. I will speak." "Very well, friend," said the young man in assent. Then the Buddha delivered to this young man a most remarkable discourse explaining truth, the gist of which is given later. It was only at the end of the discourse that this young recluse, whose name was Pukkusati, realized that the person who spoke to him was the Buddha himself. So he got up, went before the Buddha, bowed down at the feet of the master, and apologized to him for calling him friend unknowingly. Footnote: the term used is avuso, which means friend. It is a respectful term of address among equals. But disciples never used this term addressing the Buddha. Instead, they used the term bante, which approximately means sir or lord. At the time of the Buddha, the members of his order of monks, Sangha, addressed one another as avuso, friend. But before his death, the Buddha instructed younger monks to address their elders as bante, sir, or ayasma, venerable. But elders should address the younger members by name or as avuso, friend. This practice is continued up to the present day in the Sangha. End of footnote. He then begged the Buddha to ordain him and admit him to the order of the Sangha. The Buddha asked him whether he had the alms bowl and robes ready. A bhikkhu must have three robes and the alms bowl for begging food. When Pukkusati replied in the negative, the Buddha said that the Tathagatas would not ordain a person unless the alms bowl and the robes were ready. So Pukkusati went out in search of an alms bowl and robes, but was unfortunately savaged by a cow and died. Footnote: it is well known that cows in India roam about the streets. From this reference, it seems that the tradition is very old. But generally these cows are docile and not savage or dangerous. End of footnote. Later, when this sad news reached the Buddha, he announced that Pukkusati was a wise man who had already seen truth and attained the penultimate stage in the realization of nirvana, and that he was born in a realm where he would become an arahant and finally pass away, never to return to this world again. Footnote: an arahant is a person who has liberated himself from all defilements and impurities such as desire, hatred, ill will, ignorance, pride, conceit, and so on. He has attained the fourth, or the highest and ultimate stage in the realization of nirvana, and is full of wisdom, compassion, and such pure and noble qualities. Pukkusati had attained at the moment only the third stage, which is technically called Anagami, never returner. The second stage is called Sakadagami, once returner, and the first stage is called Sotapanna, stream entrant. End of footnote. From this story, it is quite clear that when Pukusati listened to the Buddha and understood his teaching, he did not know who was speaking to him or whose teaching it was. He saw truth. If the medicine is good, the disease will be cured. It is not necessary to know who prepared it or where it came from. Almost all religions are built on faith, rather blind faith, it would seem. But in Buddhism, emphasis is laid on seeing, knowing, understanding, and not on faith or belief. In Buddhist texts, there is a word sadha, Sanskrit shraddha, which is usually translated as faith or belief. But sadha is not faith as such, but rather confidence born out of conviction. In popular Buddhism, and also in ordinary usage, in the texts the word sadha, it must be admitted, has an element of faith in the sense that it signifies devotion to the Buddha, the Dhamma, teaching, and the Sangha, the order. According to Asanga, the great Buddhist philosopher of the 4th century after Christ, shraddha has three aspects. 1. Full and firm conviction that a thing is. 2. Serene joy at good qualities. And 3. Aspiration, or wish to achieve an object in view. However you put it, faith or belief as understood by most religions has little to do with Buddhism. The question of belief arises when there is no seeing, seeing in every sense of the word. The moment you see, the question of belief disappears. If I tell you that I have a gem hidden in the folded palm of my hand, the question of belief arises because you do not see it yourself. But if I unclench my fist and show you the gem, then you see it for yourself, and the question of belief does not arise. So the phrase in ancient Buddhist texts reads, realizing as one sees a gem or a mirabilan fruit in the palm. A disciple of the Buddha named Musila tells another monk, friend Savita, without devotion, faith or belief, without liking or inclination, without hearsay or tradition, without considering apparent reasons, without delight in the speculations of opinions, I know and see that the cessation of becoming is nirvana. And the Buddha says, O bhikkhus, I say that the destruction of defilement and impurities is meant for a person who knows and who sees, and not for a person who does not know and does not see. It is always a question of knowing and seeing, and not that of believing. The teaching of the Buddha is qualified as ehipassika, inviting you to come and see, but not to come and believe. The expressions used everywhere in Buddhist texts referring to persons who realized truth are the dustless and stainless eye of truth has arisen. He has seen truth, has attained truth, has known truth, has penetrated into truth, has crossed over doubt, is without wavering. Thus with right wisdom he sees it as it is. With reference to his own enlightenment, the Buddha said, the eye was born, knowledge was born, wisdom was born, science was born, light was born. It is always seeing through knowledge or wisdom, and not believing through faith. This was more and more appreciated at a time when Brahmanic orthodoxy intolerantly insisted on believing and accepting their tradition and authority as the only truth without question. Once a group of learned and well-known Brahmins went to see the Buddha and had a long discussion with him. One of the group, a Brahmin youth of 16 years of age, named Karpatika, considered by them all to be an exceptionally brilliant mind, put a question to the Buddha. Venerable Gotama, there are the ancient holy scriptures of the Brahmins handed down along the line by unbroken oral tradition of texts. With regard to them, Brahmins come to the absolute conclusion, this alone is truth, and everything else is false. Now, what does the Venerable Gotama say about this? The Buddha inquired, among Brahmins, is there any one single Brahmin who claims that he personally knows and sees that this alone is truth and everything else is false? The young man was frank and said, no. Then is there any one single teacher, or a teacher of teachers of Brahmins back to the seventh generation, or even any one of those original authors of those scriptures who claims that he knows and he sees this alone is truth and everything else is false? No. Then it is like a line of blind men, each holding on to the preceding one. The first one does not see, the middle one also does not see, the last one also does not see. Thus it seems to me that the state of the Brahmins is like that of a line of blind men. Then the Buddha gave advice of extreme importance to the group of Brahmins. It is not proper for a wise man who maintains truth to come to the conclusion, this alone is truth, and everything else is false. Asked by the young Brahmin to explain the idea of maintaining or protecting truth, the Buddha said, a man has a faith. If he says, this is my faith, so far he maintains truth. But by that, he cannot proceed to the absolute conclusion, this alone is truth, and everything else is false. In other words, a man may believe what he likes, and he may say, I believe this. So far he respects the truth. But because of his belief or faith, he should not say that what he believes is alone the truth, and everything else is false. The Buddha says, to be attached to one thing, to a certain view, and to look down upon other things as inferior, this the wise men call a fetter. Once the Buddha explained the doctrine of cause and effect to his disciples, and they said that they saw it and understood it clearly. Then the Buddha said, O bhikkhus, even this view, which is so pure and so clear, if you cling to it, if you fondle it, if you treasure it, if you are attached to it, then you do not understand that the teaching is similar to a raft, which is for crossing over and not for getting hold of. Elsewhere the Buddha explains this famous simile, in which his teaching is compared to a raft for crossing over and not for getting hold of and carrying on one's back. O bhikkhus, a man is on a journey. He comes to a vast stretch of water. On this side, the shore is dangerous. But on the other side, it is safe and without danger. No boat goes to the other shore which is safe and without danger, nor is there any bridge for crossing over. He says to himself, this sea of water is vast, and the shore on this side is full of danger. But on the other shore, it is safe and without danger. No boat goes to the other side, nor is there a bridge for crossing over. It would be good, therefore, if I would gather grass, wood, branches, and leaves to make a raft, and with the help of the raft cross over safely to the other side, exerting myself with my hands and feet. Then that man, O bhikkhus, gathers grass, wood, branches, and leaves, and makes a raft, and with the help of that raft crosses over safely to the other side, exerting himself with his hands and feet. Having crossed over and got to the other side, he thinks, this raft was of great help to me. With its aid I have crossed safely over to this side, exerting myself with my hands and feet. It would be good if I carry this raft on my head or on my back wherever I go. What do you think, O bhikkhus? If he acted in this way, would that man be acting properly with regard to the raft? No, sir. In which way, then, would he be acting properly with regard to the raft? Having crossed and gone over to the other side, suppose that man should think, "This raft was a great help to me. With its aid, I have crossed safely over to this side, exerting myself with my hands and feet. It would be good if I beached this raft on the shore, or moored it, and left it afloat, and then went on my way wherever it may be." Acting in this way, would that man act properly with regard to that raft? In the same manner, O bhikkhus, I have taught a doctrine similar to a raft. It is for crossing over, and not for carrying. You, O bhikkhus, who understand that the teaching is similar to a raft, should give up even good things, Dhamma. How much more then should you give up evil things? Footnote. Dhamma here, according to the commentary, means high spiritual attainments as well as pure views and ideas. Attachment even to these, however high and pure they may be, should be given up. How much more then should it be with regard to evil and bad things? End of footnote. From this parable, it is quite clear that the Buddha's teaching is meant to carry man to safety, peace, happiness, tranquility, the attainment of nirvana. The whole doctrine taught by the Buddha leads to this end. He did not say things just to satisfy intellectual curiosity. He was a practical teacher and taught only those things which would bring peace and happiness to man. The Buddha was once staying in a Singsapa forest in Kosambi. He took a few leaves into his hand and asked his disciples, "What do you think, O bhikkhus? Which is more, these few leaves in my hand, or the leaves in the forest over here?" "Sir, very few are the leaves in the hand of the Blessed One, but indeed the leaves in the Singsapa forest over here are very much more abundant." "Even so, bhikkhus, of what I have known, I have told you only a little. What I have not told you is very much more. And why have I not told you those things? Because that is not useful, not leading to nirvana. That is why I have not told you those things." It is futile, as some scholars vainly try to do, for us to speculate on what the Buddha...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.